Dear friends, a very good morning to everyone. In this chapter, we are going to discuss about remand, bail and bail bonds. Article 21 of Constitution of India speaks about right to liberty. It speaks that no person shall be deprived of his life or personal liberty except according to the procedure established by law. Now a question will arise whether the remand passed by the learned judicial magistrate is violative of Article 21 or not. The answer is section Article 21 says except according to the procedure established by law. The procedure established by law means the learned judicial magistrate can very well pass the order of remand because section 167 CRPC empowers the learned judicial magistrate. After going through the materials placed before him, he can pass a valid order of remand. So the order of remand passed by the judicial magistrate is not violative of Article 21 of Constitution of India. In Menaka Gandhi versus Union of India, AIR 1978 Supreme Court, page 597, has changed the scope of Article 21 by demanding that the procedure must not only be established by law, but that it must be just, fair and reasonable also. Article 21 becomes relevant as soon as a person is arrested, and it remains relevant so long as he remains subject to a criminal prosecution that has resulted or might result in the deprivation of his personal liberty. Sheila Barsi versus State of Maharashtra, AIR 1983 Supreme Court, page 378. And AIR 1985 Supreme Court, page 231, are the relevant judgments under Article 21 of Constitution of India. Learned judicial magistrate has been empowered by law, that is section 167 of CRPC. It speaks about procedure when investigation cannot be completed in 24 hours. When an accused is arrested, he must be produced before the learned magistrate within 24 hours as contemplated under section 57 of CRPC. The provision contained in section 57 CRPC is mandatory. So within 24 hours from the date of arrest, time of arrest, the accused has to be forwarded to the learned judicial magistrate with a request to remand him to judicial custody. Okay, what are all the documents to be placed before the learned magistrate? Can the remand be passed mechanically, or is there any procedure to take an accused into judicial custody? Is the bigger question now. Yes, no doubt, learned judicial magistrate cannot pass the order of remand mechanically. Learned judicial magistrate has to pass the order of remand after applying his judicial mind into the facts of the case. The materials placed before the learned magistrate has to be scrupulously considered before passing the order of remand. In section 167 itself, it has been stated that if there are grounds for believing that the accusation or information is well-founded, the officer in charge of the police station or the police officer making the investigation, if he is not below the rank of sub-inspector, shall forthwith transmit to the nearest judicial magistrate a copy of the entries made in the diary. This is contemplated, this is available in section 167 CRPC. So what has to be forwarded? The first diary, copy of the entries in the diary, and first information report and the copy of complaint has to be forwarded to the learned judicial magistrate when the first remand is requested. So the learned magistrate has to go through the first diary, has to go through the informations and to come to a conclusion whether the accusation then is well founded, and only then a valid remand can be passed. It amounts to taking cognizance. No doubt, what action of the learned judicial magistrate would amounts to taking cognizance has not been defined in the court. But as soon as a learned judicial magistrate applies his judicial mind into the facts, he is said to have taken cognizance. Insofar as order of remand is concerned, the learned judicial magistrate has taken cognizance for a limited purpose, that is, whether accused can be taken into judicial custody or not. So, in order to take judicial custody, learned magistrate has to apply his judicial mind, and then only order of remand can be passed. Section 167 CRPC speaks about two types of custody. One is police custody and another is judicial custody. As soon as an accused has been taken into custody by the police, that is, if a person is detained by the police, he has to be forwarded to the learned magistrate within 24 hours from the date of arrest, and the learned magistrate has to authorize the detention of the accused person otherwise than in the custody of the police. That means judicial custody has to be passed. That means authorization of detention. The detention of the accused by the police has been authorized judicially by the learned judicial magistrate. The word remand is absent in section 167 CRPC, and the word remand is made only in section 309 CRPC. The learned magistrate has to go through the materials placed before him, and he has to come to a conclusion that the accusation or informations are well founded. The officer has to transmit a copy of the entries to the learned judicial magistrate, and we all know the authorization of custody cannot be made mechanically, and there must be application of mind. No doubt, the subordinate judiciary has no inherent power. If the provision of law authorizes a judicial officer to pass an order, then order can be passed, no doubt. Which law confers right to the judicial magistrate to take the accused into custody, to authorize the detention of the accused? Yes, section 167 subclass 1 and 2 gives and confers power to the learned judicial magistrate to authorize the detention of the accused into judicial custody. A doubt will arise whether order of remand, authorization of detention, can be passed only by the judicial magistrate or by executive magistrate also. We know there are two types of magistrates, one judicial magistrate and executive magistrate. Section 11 of CRPC speaks about courts of judicial magistrate. Section 20 speaks about executive magistrates. Section 167 2 capital A speaks that when a judicial magistrate is not available, when a judicial magistrate is not available, an accused can be transmitted to the nearest executive magistrate on whom the powers of judicial magistrate or metropolis magistrate have been conferred. That is, to invoke section 167 2 capital A, power of judicial magistrate or power of the metropolitan magistrate should have been conferred on a executive magistrate. Then an accused can be transmitted to such executive magistrate with a request to authorize the detention of the accused. Incidentally, another question will arise, whether executive magistrate can authorize the detention of the accused for 15 days? No. Section itself, it has been clarified for a term not exceeding 7 days in the aggregate. So, at the most, the remand can be passed for about 7 days only by the executive magistrate. The authorization of detention of an accused under section 167(2) CRPC is the precognizance stage. Precognizance stage, post cognizance stage, bail, post judgment. We are going to discuss under the three headings: precognizance stage, post cognizance stage, and bail, post judgment. Precognizance stage means when a case is under investigation. Post cognizance stage means after taking cognizance on a final report, that is pending trial, pending investigation, pending trial, and after trial. So we are going to discuss on the three topic. Section 209 CRPC, Section 309(2) CRPC, Section 267 CRPC deals with post cognizance stage, remand during post cognizance stage during trial. Section 390 speaks about appeal under Section 378. High Court may issue warrant directing that the accused be arrested and brought before it. Bail, post judgment. As soon as the learned trial judge coming to a conclusion that the charges leveled against the accused has been proved and the guilt of the accused has been established by the prosecution, this finding is known as conviction, and following the conviction, sentence will be awarded. As soon as sentence is awarded, the right will be given to the accused to prefer an appeal. So there will be a right to move the application for suspension of conviction, suspension of sentence, suspension of fine, as well suspension of compensation. The trial judge can suspend the sentence if sentence is not above 3 years. Sentence includes sentence of fine, sentence of compensation. No doubt, suspension of conviction can be ordered. The sentence of imprisonment, sentence of fine, as well compensation can also be suspended by the appellate court. After an order of acquittal, if an appeal against acquittal is presented and coming up for admission, the Honorable High Court may issue warrant directing that the accused be arrested and brought before the High Court, and High Court, Honorable High Court, can grant bail to the accused. Arrest and custody, they are not synonyms. If an accused is arrested, no doubt he will be under the custody of the police officer. If a person is under the custody, he need not be arrested. He is under surveillance of the police officer. So the arrest and custody are distinct. The clear distinction between arrest and custody is,
in every arrest there will be custody, but not vice versa. In section 27 of Indian Evidence Act also, the term custody of a police officer has been used. The word custody used in section 27 of Indian Evidence Act only denotes surveillance or restriction on the movements of the person concerned. AR 1970 Bombay, page 79, equivalent 1970 Criminal Law Journal, page 325, 1969 MLJ Criminal, page 765. Immediate after the arrest, within 24 hours, accused will be forwarded to the judicial magistrate to get authorization of the detention. And as soon as detention of an accused by the police is authorized, that means remand is passed, the arrestee can move application for bail. Bail in bailable offense, bail in non-bailable offense, and bail in offenses exclusively triable by the court of sessions. Section 436 speaks about bail in bailable offense. Accused, if unable to furnish surety within a week of arrest, he is known as indigent person. He shall be discharged on his own bond. It is mandatory. Bail in bailable offense and non-bailable offense is dealt with under section 437 CRPC. Section 438 speaks about anticipatory bail. Section 437 subclass 5 CRPC and 439 subclass 2 CRPC speaks about cancellation of bail. Section 439 CRPC is the special powers of Court of Session and the Honorable High Court regarding bail. No doubt, there is no provision for cancellation of bail in a bailable offense. It doesn't mean that bail in a bailable offense cannot be cancelled at all. The language contained in Section 439 Subclass 2 CRPC is amply clear. Bail granted under this chapter can be cancelled. So bail in a bailable offense cannot be cancelled by the learned judicial magistrate. Section 436, bail in a bailable offense. 436 capital A, maximum period for which an under trial prisoner can be detained. 437, bail in a non-bailable offense. 437 capital A, bail to require accused to appear next appellate court. 438, anticipatory bail. Section 439, special power of the High Court and Court of Session. Section 440, amount of bond and reduction. Section 441, bond of accused and sureties. 441 capital A, declaration of sureties. 442, discharge from custody. 443, power to order sufficient bail. 444, discharge of sureties. 445, deposit instead of recognition. Section 446, procedure when bail bond has been forfeited. Section 446 capital A, cancellation of bond and bail bond. 447, procedure, insolvency and death of surety. 448, bond from minor. 449, appeal from orders under section 446. 450, power to direct levy of amount due on certain recognizance. Section 436 CRPC speaks about bail in a bailable offense. Section 2A defines bailable offense. There is no provision to cancel bail in a bailable offense. In Pillappan alias Ravikumar versus State,
reported in 2018 to MLJ Criminal 502. Guidelines have been given by the Madras High Court. Bail in bailable offence, anticipatory bail and bail in non-bailable offence
are all covered under section 439 subclass 2 CRPC for the purpose of cancellation of bail. Section 439 2 CRPC enables the court of session and the high court to cancel the bail granted under this chapter, bail and bail bonds. So bail in a bailable offence, bail in a non-bailable offence and also anticipatory bail are all liable to be cancelled if situation warrants at the hands of the court of session and the Honorable High Court by exercising the power under section 439 subclass 2 CRPC. Bail in bailable offence, non-bailable offence. Incidentally, a question will arise. Some offences are classified as exclusively tribal by court of sessions in the schedule attached to the Code of Criminal Procedure 1973. A doubt will arise whether the learned judicial magistrate can grant bail in the case which are exclusively tribal by the court of sessions. No doubt the learned judicial magistrate can grant bail in those cases, but if punishment is life imprisonment or capital punishment, then the learned judicial magistrate cannot grant bail. There are two judgments on the point. 2001 SEC Criminal, page 674. 2001 SEC Criminal, page 674. 2005 MLJ Criminal, page 85. Judgment of Madurai Bench of Madras High Court. Bail under section 167 subclass 2 CRPC is mandatory and absolute. Now let us see what are all the differences between the bail under section 437 subclass 6 and bail under section 167 2 CRPC. Bail under section 167 2 CRPC is mandatory as well absolute. It cannot be denied and merits of the case cannot be looked into. That is why the bail under section 167.2 is known as default bail. Merit can not at all be argued when an application for bail under section 167.2 is filed. Is there any exception to section 167.2 CRPC? Yes. Under the prosecution NDPS Act, if a prosecution is initiated under Unlawful Activities Prevention Act and Maharashtra Organized Crime Act and Tada cases, there are special provisions excluding the operation of 167.2 CRPC. That is within 60 or 90 days as the case may be. You all know well, Special Act override the CRPC. So as per the specific provisions made in the special law, section 167.2 is exempted. When section 437 subclass 6 is applicable, the point number 1 is date of examination of witnesses must be fixed, and after the date of examination of witnesses is fixed, trial if not concluded within 6 months, then bail is mandatory. Whether it is absolute or not is the next question. It is not absolute. Merit can be taken into consideration. That is, if reasons to be recorded, if there are special reasons available to reject the claim of bail, it can be rejected. So the bail under section 437 subclass 6 is mandatory but not absolute. In bailable offence, whether conditions can be imposed by the Leonard judicial magistrate? No. In bailable offences, bail is must, mandatory, no condition can be imposed by the Leonard magistrate. In an offence exclusively tribal by the court of sessions, Leonard judicial magistrate has got power to grant bail. Almost in all cases of grant of bail, conditions will be imposed. Now a question will arise whether the Leonard magistrate or judges can impose any condition or within the scope of section 437 subclass 3, 438 subclass 2 and 439 1A alone can be imposed is the question. No doubt Leonard judge can grant bail with conditions, but that condition should not be a onerous condition, like to deposit cash security, to produce close relative as a surety, to produce sale deed, and to do any work like to remove karuvela tree and all the other things. There are number of judgments on the point. The conditions as contemplated under section 437(3), 438 subclass 2 and 439 1A alone can be imposed. 2018 volume 1 Law Weekly Criminal page 102, 2015 MLJ Criminal page 471, AR 2009 Supreme Court 2072, 2015 2 Madras Weekly Notes Criminal page 438, 2017 1 Law Weekly Criminal page 800, 2009 12 SEC page 721.
Judges and judicial magistrate has power to remand the accused under section 167(2) CRPC. This power is not absolute. The power to remand will come to an end after 60 or 90 days as the case may be. This restriction or this limitation has been only on the power of the Leonard judicial magistrate. If no valid final report has been forwarded to the judicial magistrate concerned, then indivisible right on the accused to get bail will arise. Constitutional bench judgment of Honorable Supreme Court will give guidance to all of us. The date of arrest cannot be taken into consideration to calculate the time. It commences only from the first remand. No notice to the public prosecutor is necessary, and the application under section 167(2) CRPC has to be decided forthwith. The bail granted under section 167(2) CRPC is also liable to be cancelled, but not on the ground of subsequently final report has been filed. The defective charge sheet cannot be considered as the final report in terms of section 173(2) CRPC. As in the case of bail under section 436, 437 and 439, no onerous condition can be imposed while granting bail under section 167(2) CRPC. 2019 volume 2 TNLR page 934, 2019 volume 2 Law Weekly Criminal page 629. Whether the Leonard judicial magistrate has got power to extend the period of remand after the 60 days or 90 days as the case may be, even if no final report is forwarded? No. The power given to the Leonard judicial magistrate to authorize the detention will come to an end
after 60 days or 90 days as the case may be. The only condition is if no final report is forwarded. If final report is received, then section 309 will come into play to pass order of remand. Related judgments, 2011, 1 SEC criminal, page 1099, CBI versus Anupam Kulkarni and other cases, even in 1995 criminal law journal, page 477, Supreme Court is the landmark judgment on the point between Sanjay Dutt versus CBI. This is the constitutional bench judgment, so it is a guiding judgment. Bail under special laws. When an application for bail is granted or dismissed by the special court under SCST Act, then we cannot move bail application before the Honorable High Court. We have to file an appeal under section 14A2 of SCST Act. And to prefer an appeal against the order of bail or dismissal of bail under section SCST Act, the appeal can be filed within 90 days from the date of order. And the time limit has to be followed section 14A3 of SCST Act. Section 438 of CRPC is not applicable. So as per section 18 of the Act, Part 3, post judgment bail. As soon as the learned judge come to a conclusion after appreciation of evidence that the guilt of the accused has been proved by the prosecution beyond all reasonable doubt, learned judge will record accused is guilty, and following the same, sentence will be awarded. The finding of the criminal court that the accused is guilty, this finding is known as conviction, and following conviction only a sentence will be awarded. So conviction and sentence is a inseparable twins. The conviction and sentence can be suspended. Sentence includes sentence of imprisonment, sentence of fine, sentence of compensation. So the sentence of imprisonment, sentence of fine, as well compensation can be suspended, and conviction can also be suspended. Section 389 is governing the field. Section 389 subclass 1, pending any appeal by convicted person, the appellate court may, for reasons to be recorded by it in writing, order that the execution of the sentence or order appealed against be suspended, and also if he is in confinement that he be released on bail or on his own bond. The word "the execution of the sentence or order appealed against be suspended" has been coined in section 389(1) CRPC. So order appealed against be suspended. So this provision confers the right on the appellate court even to suspend the conviction, suspend the sentence of imprisonment, sentence of fine, and also sentence of compensation. So whether the learned trial judge can suspend the sentence, if that be so, is there any restriction on the learned trial judge is the question. Section 389 subclass 3 is relevant, where the convicted person satisfy the court, satisfies the court by which he is convicted, that is the trial court, that he intends to present an appeal, the court shall, where such person being on bail is sentenced to imprisonment for a term not exceeding 3 years. So the condition is coming. If sentence is not exceeding 3 years, then the learned trial judge can suspend the sentence. Where the offence of which such person has been convicted is a bailable one and he is on bail, then the sentence can be suspended by the trial court. Suspension of conviction. There must be a proper pleadings in the application praying to suspend the conviction. What are all the effect of suspension of conviction? If not suspended, has to be pleaded properly. 1995 2SEC page 513, 1995 2SEC page 513, Rama Narang case is the landmark judgment. Then 2007 volume 2SEC page 574, suspension of conviction. Suspension of sentence by trial court, section 389 subclass 3 CRPC, 389 1 CRPC, suspension of sentence by appellate court. Suspension of fine, 2000 volume 2 crimes 383, AIR 1976 Supreme Court 1263. Suspension of compensation, 2014 1 crimes 325. Suspension of conviction, sentence fine can also be cancelled. AIR 1951 Madras 1042, 1989 Criminal Law Journal page 163. Conviction can be executable. Following the conviction, sentence will be awarded. It may incur a disqualification. In such a situation, conviction can be suspended. There must be a proper pleadings. If conviction is not suspended, irreparable injury will be caused to the appellant. So we have to properly pleaded in the application. 1995 2SEC page 513 and other three judgments are there on the point. So no doubt, suspension of conviction can also be suspended. Sentence includes sentence of imprisonment, sentence of fine and compensation. 1998 Criminal Law Journal page 3719, 2000 volume 2 crimes page 383, AIR 1976 Supreme Court 1263, 1987 Criminal Law Journal 1838. Incidentally, a question will arise. Though there is a provision to cancel the bail under section 437(5) and 439 subclass 2, is there any provision to cancel the suspension of sentence? Though there is no special provision or specific provision, in appropriate cases, suspension of sentence can also be cancelled. AIR 1951 Madras page 1042, 1989 Criminal Law Journal 163 Madhya Pradesh. An intervener has no right to be heard.